Robin Soderman. Welcome to the
Thank you.
Podcast from Antiloop. Absolute legend in the EDM world, and so let's go straight back to the beginning. How did it all start?
Many years ago, I really started liking music, the technical side of it. One of my first strong memories was me and my family was at a friend's house, and she had this big amplifier in the living room, and she always played music. Now, I started examining that amplifier, noticing that I could adjust the bass and the treble for another sound, which really that mesmerized me. I was amazed by that, and that one of my first technical memories. I still remember the, and this must have been over 40 years ago. So that led me on to a technical interest, but especially music-wise, if you know what I mean. So when turntables came around, music was a natural part of my family. My father was a musician. So I at the age of 14, I started playing records. Now in Sweden, we have something called the fritidsgårdar, which was a great thing. It's like a community house. And there were different community houses in your vicinity, so to speak. So every bigger area of housing also had a fritidsgård. And this was paid for by the community, and kids could go there, play pool, play music, hang out every day. This has become pretty rare in Sweden, and everybody's talking about how many of the problems we face today could have been avoided if youths could get together and meet as we did 30 years ago, 40 years ago in these fritidsgårdar. However, they picked me up early because they saw this interest for music, and I hang around on their disco evenings. And one of the people that worked there asked me, "Do you want to play records the next Friday?" And I was like, "Hell yeah, I don't have any records." And she was like, "No worries, use ours." So I started DJing there at the age of 14. And it could be 50, 60, 70, 100 people every night, Fridays, Saturdays, which was a lot of fun. So I started buying my own records. Skip forward a couple of years, where I lived in Sweden, they started building a really big youth house. So I was asked as a DJ, "Would you mind being responsible for maybe some of the music nights when it comes to dance music?" And I said yes, and I moved on. And me and my friends, we didn't build a house. It was an old electricity station. However, we actually got the opportunity to play records there every night. Some of my friends were more into the concert thing, so they were responsible for mixing the concerts. Everything funded by the community, but also maintained by us youths. So this really got me a flying start into music, and really being able, even though I couldn't afford it myself, actually play on Technics 1200s and a reasonable mixer, learning a lot.
I was just going to ask you that. What was the gear like? Because I mean, when I started DJing, it was the Technics and the vinyl and everything. Obviously, you know, I think I had a Vestax mixer or something.
They were popular at the time. Yeah.
You know, because that was the one that you had. You know, you couldn't get the ones that they had in the clubs at that time. You know, you had to buy but I'm just curious because that's interesting. So you've fallen into this position of like a kind of community.
I'm not using the exact word. It's paid by the government basically, but it's on a local level. So they were financing these fritidsgårdar, and then they built a really big one called the House of the Youth, basically. But to answer your question, 1200s, 1210s, Technics, we could basically buy whatever we wanted, but it wasn't our gear. It was everybody's gear, but we were responsible for it. And I think we had courses in DJing. long story short, I remember I wanted to play electronic dance music. That's what we bought. That's what we liked. Me and my friends, we were a lot into Aphex Twin, Mouse on Mars, really strange ambient music. However, this was hard because people wanted commercial dance music. But what really interested me was playing what I thought was interesting dance music and actually getting people to dance to it, sort of playing the stuff they didn't know they wanted. What happened was a couple of years later, a friend of mine started a studio collective, so to speak. His idea was, okay, I will attract a lot of young talent DJs, asking them if they want to work in the studio. So we went there. I was DJing a lot at the time, but did a lot of commercial gigs, which was wearing me out because I was feeling DJing was not fun anymore because they wanted to hear Bon Jovi and stuff like that. And yeah, I really wanted the money. So I did a lot of gigs because I wanted to buy more gear getting into music production. Now, at the time, I actually stopped DJing and only started making music when this guy called me and asked, do you want to join the studio collective? So we did. And he also asked me, do you know any other people that might be interested in joining this studio? And I thought of my old friend David from the first youth fritidsgård. Actually, we were all the childhood friends. He had come and seen me DJ at the first fritidsgård. So I said, you know what, let's call David. And I called David and I said, there's a studio here. We can actually spend time here. The only thing we need to do is get some gear and put into the studio. Others will do the same. And in the end, we will have a nice studio collective. So he said, yes, he showed up and we started making music. All people in this collective started making music together, which was very interesting. And a friend of mine came by and he said, this sounds interesting. I know a guy that knows people in record companies in Stockholm downtown. Why don't you give me a tape? Or rather, he put us in contact with each other. So the guy that knew people in record companies in Sweden, he was working at where they make commercials for big companies. He was AD copy or something. Really, he's really, I must thank him for a lot of our success, because what he did, he took a tape from us. We sent that 10 different songs. I worked with three or four different people, but me and David made a song on that DAT called Beauty and the Beast. So we sent it to him. His name is Martin Stadhammar. He received it. He gave us some feedback, but he passed it on to Stockholm Records sub-label called Fluid at the time. Now, what Stockholm Records did, he was smart. Ola Håkansson, one of the main founders of Stockholm Records that later was bought up by Universal, he understood that today's DJs will be tomorrow's pop producers.
It's a very interesting combination, because David, he's a musician and he starts to play piano when he was 12 or something like that. Robin, on the other hand, he was an extremely good computer man, so the first hacker I've ever met. So here was a great combination of a very, very talented musician and a very talented engineer.
He already figured that out. So what he did, he funded two guys, Magnus Nordin and Glenn Carlson. They had a group called MDA, and they made a big tune called Take an E and We Hate Sunrise, two big tracks. I like it. that came from them. Yeah. It was all sampled and put together from other tracks, but really, really cool dance music. They sounded right. So they had a big hit in the UK. Ola Håkansson gave them money, said, do whatever you want, start this under label to Stockholm Records called Flu Records. Long story short, they received the DAT and got back to us, said, we want number 6 or 7 on the DAT. And we checked, and it was me and David, Beauty and the Beast. So we got signed to Fluid Records. They released it. And almost immediately, Swedish National Radio, P3, started playing Beauty and the Beast. And it leaked over, started being played during daytime as well. Now, this is kind of significant because Beauty and the Beast was more or less fully instrumental. Music like that wasn't really played on Swedish National Radio, but they had a show called P3 Club and P3 Dance, and they liked playing instrumental music. But the cool thing was that daytime radio on P3 actually picked it up. So they put it on B rotation or something, meaning we could hear our song at lunchtime in Sweden, all over Sweden. That was incredibly inspiring, and it really thrusted both me and David into, hey, we actually have our song on the radio. It's usually the dream of anyone making music. Our music started playing on the Swedish National Radio, and that was the start of it. This is 94. And the record company said, why don't you come and join our studio downtown? So we moved the whole studio, and we started working in this with 3 or 4 other producers in the Fluid Record Studios, or actually it was Stockholm Record Studios. This was incredibly inspiring because we kept on hearing other people making the same kind of music or instrumental dance music as we did. And one day I came down to the studio and David played a theme. He said, listen to this. And the theme was dang 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 bum 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 bum. And I said, this is a hit. Let's add some drums. We started adding drums, and that became in my mind. This is late 96.
In my mind.